fund might be up.
Okay, good afternoon. Can I remind members that social distancing measures...
Point of order.
Minutes after we thought we were going to start the debate. Is there any way that we can move decision time 14 minutes later?
Let's see how we get on. I'm grateful for the point of order. Let's see how we get on, and I think we can make an assessment about that later on in this afternoon's debate. Can we now continue with the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 366 in the name of Marie Todd on women's health. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the requested speak buttons now. For those joining us remotely, please put R in the chat function. I call on Marie Todd to speak to move the motion. You have around 11 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The COVID-19 pandemic has changed and challenged almost all aspects of life, but its impact has not been felt equally across the population. Women have been more adversely impacted. Pre-existing inequalities have been exposed and exacerbated. Let's be clear, women's health isn't just a woman's issue. When women are supported to lead healthy lives and fulfil their potential, everyone benefits. The majority of unpaid carers are women. Women make up the majority of the health and social care workforce, and the vast majority of lone parents are women. The challenges of balancing childcare, paid work, and caring responsibilities with the stresses and uncertainties of the pandemic will have been truly daunting for many women and undoubtedly have affected their health. Still, the inequality that women face throughout their lives existed long before COVID. In her thought-provoking book, Invisible Women, Caroline Criado-Perez says so much in the few words. Women are not, to state the obvious, just men. She goes on to explain, historically, it's been assumed that there wasn't anything fundamentally different between male and female bodies other than size and reproductive function. And so for many years, medical education has been focused on the male norm, with everything that falls outside that designated as atypical or even abnormal. Let's look at abnormal. Women are more likely to experience violence, to live in poverty, to live alone, particularly in older age, and care for others, all of which contribute to poorer mental health. Throughout this year, we've invested £6 million of support to support mental health. It's vital that we consider the specific mental health needs of women. In October 2020, we launched the Mental Health Transition and Recovery Plan, which specifically prioritises women and girls' mental health. We're working with our Equalities Forum to deliver a programme of work to address the challenges arising from the pandemic. Women live longer than men and make up a larger portion of the older age population and are more likely to spend more time in ill health. Yet women don't always receive equal health care. Their physical and mental health is compromised every day by systems that do not yet fully meet their needs. Health outcomes for women are poorer in important areas such as heart health. Women having heart attacks are often said to have an atypical presentation. That language shines a light on a very important issue. Women are not atypical men, they're women. The way women present is normal for women, and that lack of recognition of the presentation is then followed by studies showing that women are less likely to be prescribed drugs that reduce the chance of a second heart attack. The British Heart Foundation highlight inequalities at every stage of a woman's medical journey. Health inequalities such as this are unjust and preventable. Let's talk about endometriosis. 1 in 10 women in Scotland have endometriosis, making it as common as diabetes and asthma. And yet we know that women are waiting far too long for a diagnosis. So we are listening to women to understand the barriers they're facing to achieving a diagnosis, to make sure that we can make progress as quickly as possible. And we're also ensuring that the individual needs of women are met throughout their treatment. Let's talk about menopause. Women are frustrated that information, particularly in relation to menstrual health and menopause, is unreliable and inaccessible. Many feel unprepared for the impact that the menopause can have on their life and feel unsupported to manage symptoms. We're working to raise awareness of the symptoms of menopause and to ensure that all women receive the support and the care that they need to sustain their health and well-being. These reasons, and many others, are why, within 100 days of this new term, we will publish a women's health plan. The plan will reduce avoidable inequalities in health outcomes for women throughout their lives. Central to its development and implementation will be women's voices and experiences. We've already conducted a women's health survey alongside the Health and Social Care Alliance and spoken directly to women. We want to give women a say in how we shape services for the future, and it's absolutely crucial that we listen to women and that we trust women. Certainly.
Monica Lennon.
I'm grateful to the Minister and welcome her to her new post. I agree with what she said so far. Does she agree that to really get the benefit of all those measures that we need to embed menstrual wellbeing education into the curriculum, and what plans does she have to speak to colleagues across government to make sure that that happens?
Minister.
So certainly the challenge doesn't start just in the doctor's surgery. The challenge is a societal one, and we do need to change that and ensure that from a young age, children of both boys and girls have an understanding of menstrual health and of the course of a woman's life and how that will impact her. I think the idea of education during school is certainly an appropriate one, but there are also other opportunities when women are presenting for, say, breast screening, for cervical screening. There are lots of opportunities to talk about menstrual health with women and to raise awareness of the challenges that we face. And I certainly will be trying to improve the situation. Developed over the last 18 months by women and experts on women's health, the plan's initial priorities are improving abortion services, contraception and sexual health, menopause and menstrual health, including endometriosis, and women's heart health. Through necessity, the pandemic led to new and innovative ways of working and of providing patient care, and these are captured in the Women's Health Plan for longer-term implementation. To make lasting change, a cultural shift is required. The plan therefore approaches women's health in a holistic way, responding to the many factors that impact on women's health and their ability to access healthcare services. The plan has a life course approach to women's health, emphasising the importance of protecting and promoting health at key stages of life. From preconception to pregnancy, childhood and adolescence, to adulthood and later life, it is vital that women have the information that they need, when they need it, and in a way that is right for them. That meaningful communication personalises care. It improves the safety and effectiveness of care, and it helps to address health inequalities. At every stage, we must give women the opportunity and support they need to access and participate in decisions about their care. Moving away from a doctor-knows-best culture, we will empower women to make informed decisions about their bodies and their health. We'll learn from the pandemic, and we'll build back with equality at the centre of all that we do. We can reduce some health inequalities by identifying gaps in health service provision, considering areas of best practice and developing actions to address these gaps. But this plan is only one part of a much wider picture when it comes to women's health and well-being. The majority of health inequalities are avoidable. They stem from wider inequality in society, income, wealth, and power. Work is being undertaken across government to address these wider social determinants of health, to eradicate poverty and to tackle inequality in all aspects of life. There's a significant amount of work being undertaken right across government to improve women's health, particularly in... certainly.
Jackie Bailey.
Thank you. On the point about inequality, could I specifically ask the Minister whether she will commit to reforming care allowance as soon as possible to ensure that unpaid carers can earn more from work? Because I'm sure she'll appreciate they are predominantly women.
Minister.
So the member will be aware that that is not my portfolio, but I am absolutely well aware that more women are carers, and that is one of the reasons that impacts on their health. So yes, I will be working in a cross-governmental approach. I'm very keen that we can achieve cross-parliamentary consensus today to take that work forward with everyone in agreement that these issues need to be tackled in order to improve women's health. There's a significant amount of work being taken across government to improve women's health in regard to mesh, maternal health and screening services. And the plan will build on those successes and align with COVID-19 recovery. Again, Deputy Presiding Officer, to finish, I'm going to finish with another quote from Caroline Criado Perez, a book I would recommend to everyone in the chamber. The evidence that women are being let down by the medical establishment is overwhelming. Half the world's population are being dismissed, disbelieved, and ignored. Our ambition is for a Scotland where health outcomes are equitable right across the population, so that all women can enjoy the best possible health throughout their lives. Our Women's Health Plan will provide a foundation for us all in government, health, and social care, and society as a whole to work together to achieve this. I look forward to listening to the views of the members today, and I hope that across the Parliament we can find common cause in better listening to, understanding and meeting the needs of women in Scotland today. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Can I thank you also for keeping to time as well as taking interventions. I now call on Annie Wells to speak to Move Amendment 369.1. Ms Wells, you have 7 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be given the opportunity to speak in today's debate. But I would firstly like to take this opportunity to lend my support to the Cervical Screening Awareness Week. Cervical screening, also known as a smear test, is a life-saving test. However, many people find this test difficult due to a variety of reasons, such as anxiety or previous trauma. Indeed, over a quarter of those invited to do the test did not take up their invitation. And it's also concerning that figures from Public Health Scotland show that in 2019 and 2020, there was a lower uptake of cervical screening among those from more deprived areas. That's why campaigns such as Cervical Screening Awareness Week are so important. And I would like to hear from this government as to how they will work to close the gap between the most and least deprived areas when it comes to cervical screening. Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust have launched their own campaign for the week, which aims to encourage open conversation about cervical screening. It also aims to issue clear guidance to women and people with a cervix on how to access vital support they may need, and I would urge people to visit their website for more information. Presiding Officer, in the coming months, as more Scots are vaccinated and we look to carefully ease restrictions, there will be an opportunity for us all to reflect on our experiences of the pandemic. What we can immediately recognise is the invaluable role women have and continue to play in protecting the NHS against the virus. Many health and social care professions in Scotland, indeed the world, are dominated by women. We cannot lose sight of the key role women have played in treating and caring for some of the most vulnerable in society against this deadly disease. However, we can't wait until the pandemic has passed. It's an urgent and renewed focus on improving women's health now. Advocacy group Engender have issued a stark warning that there is a concern that women's health problems are being dismissed, underestimated and diagnosed late. And let me be clear, the Scottish Conservatives are committed to ensuring women's health and wellbeing needs are met across their whole lifetime. And as we've heard from the Minister, despite making up half the population, as a society, we often avoid talking about many of the health issues women face. This must change. In light of this, the Scottish Conservatives have welcomed the Government's commitment to a women's health plan. We on these benches look forward to the opportunity to carefully scrutinise the government's plan following its publication. Presiding officer, in the NHS recovery plan debate a fortnight ago, I spoke about how, as our healthcare services remobilised following COVID, we need to improve the services that women across Scotland rely on. The NHS needs bolstered with significant financial support if we are to tackle the backlog, which threatens to delay and even deny vital treatment for Scottish women. That's why, as part of the Scottish Conservatives' amendment to the government's motion today, we're calling for a clinician-led ring-fenced fund with the sole remit of bringing treatment times under control. This would help to ensure, despite the immense pressure placed upon our healthcare system by the pandemic, that our NHS is responsive to the health concerns and well-being of women. Take the condition endometriosis, where the average time for a diagnosis in Scotland is 8.5 years, according to an inquiry by the All-Party Parliamentary Group on the issue. The inquiry also noted that in Scotland, it has been difficult for some women to access specialist endometriosis centres, even if they are suffering from deep endometriosis. And another area of concern regarding women's health, presiding officer, is that of breast cancer, the most common cancer in women in Scotland, accounting for 28.8% of all cancers diagnosed. Only recently have Cancer Research UK revealed that 1,000 fewer people have started breast cancer treatment in the last year in Scotland compared to the year before. This highlights the tremendous scale of the NHS backlog in this instance and how the queues for essential treatments are growing at a startling rate. And moreover, I agree with the Minister where she stresses the importance of recognising the link between health and income inequality. As is the case, as I've already mentioned, with cervical screenings, the figures show that women from the most deprived areas of Scotland are less likely to attest breast screening appointments also. Whether it be endometriosis, breast or cervical cancer, presiding officer, I again stress that it is vital we have targeted resources dedicated to tackling the backlog and addressing lengthy waiting times in these key areas of women's health. Finally, presiding officer, on an issue I know which will be discussed passionately across this chamber today, is the findings surrounding the transvaginal mesh surgery. It is important to praise the efforts of the Scottish Mesh Survivors Group, a group of heroic women who have worked tirelessly over the years to raise awareness of the dangers of mesh. This scandal, being a traumatic and harmful experience for victims involved, needs a resolution as soon as possible. I am clear that I stand side by side with colleagues across this chamber to call on this government to urgently introduce financial support to refund the women who paid for private mesh surgery, often out with the NHS. Presiding officer, as I mentioned at the beginning of this speech, women make up half of our population, but serious discussions about our unique healthcare needs are often shied away from. This can be no more. The barriers women face to good physical and mental health are clear, and the pandemic continues to place significant pressures on the NHS. With a laser-eyed focus, however, let us recommit ourselves to supporting women's health by giving the NHS the proper funding it needs to tackle the backlog and be responsive to the healthcare needs of women across Scotland. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Ms Wells. I now call on Carol Mochen to speak to and move Amendment 369.4. Ms Mochen, you have 6 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is, of course, very welcome that women's health is receiving some of the spotlight it deserves in this chamber today, and I'm delighted to be opening for Scottish Labour. I want to focus on the way in which women continue to be treated as second-class citizens in Scotland, whether by neglect or design. There is only so long that the government can keep turning up with motions celebrating plans as yet unannounced. People want action, and that's what Scottish Labour continue to focus on, and I will focus on in today's debate. Scottish Labour have pushed for action on women and women's health throughout the last Parliament. an example of action from my colleague Monica Lennon, who did so much to improve the provision of free period products with world-leading legislation. This is action. But I am sure Monica would agree there is still a great deal more to do, and we can only achieve this by working together and using the powers of the Parliament. I worked for many years in the NHS and saw firsthand the ways in which medical concerns of women are so often dismissed as a minor consideration or just cast off as a byproduct of personal responsibility. It is vital that people in my position, in our position, speak up for those who are unable to do so. And I know that from my constituents that the stigma surrounding menopause, access to specialist mental health support, and waiting times for breast cancer screening appointments are just a few of the ways in which women do not feel their needs are taken into consideration in Scotland. Menopause symptoms in particular remain heavily stigmatised, many women so reluctant to ask for help or share experiences. The specialist services must have greater equality and access to allow women to be confident in coming forward and accessing treatment. But there is perhaps no greater example in contemporary Scotland of that neglect than the treatment of the survivors of the transvaginal mesh scandal. This is an issue that my Labour colleague Neil Findlay did so much to raise awareness of during the last Parliament. And alongside other MSPs from other parties, there were some successes, but still questions left unanswered. The work of the Scottish Mesh Survivors Campaign has repeatedly revealed the extent to which these women trusted the NHS to treat them. They were led to believe that the mesh was safe, only to be left with life-changing injuries. We know that many of these women are now left unable to work or live a normal life, suffering from the dreadful social and financial impacts that follow from that. Scottish Labour are pursuing this and so many other issues because we see the advancement of women's health as a core concern of a modern country focused on justice. We believe that by supporting women to live healthy lives, we build the blocks of a national health service. For all of the posturing, I'm not sure the same can be said of the SNP. And here is the recent record, and it isn't even close to acceptable. Over 43,000 breast cancer screening appointments were cancelled in 2020, and at least 180,000 cervical screening tests delayed. Fewer than 3/5 of women from the most deprived areas of Scotland attend breast screening appointments, compared to nearly 4/5 of women in the most affluent communities. Scotland only has 2 mother and baby mental health units, with the Royal College of Physicians in Scotland saying that the mental health treatment for new mothers is akin to a postcode lottery. And finally, and I urge members to remember this statistic, on average, women with endometriosis wait 8 years from the condition to receiving a test. Scottish Labour want to start turning back the tide, and as you can see from our amendment today, a first step and an absolutely necessary step is to recognise today as an opportunity to right the wrongs suffered by Scotland's mesh survivors and give a guarantee that they will be able to access the compensation they deserve. If we can help this group of women, we can give hope to those who believe their own concerns have been forgotten, that things can change for the better. Today in this Parliament, yet let's use the powers for once to redress the balance for a group of people who have no institutional power, just their own solidarity, compassion and desire for justice. I know that the SNP claim to support this in principle, but so far they have come up with more excuses than solutions. It is long past time we got this done and delivered the vital funding to these women so that they can get back to some sense of normality and not feel left behind by an establishment that seems to distance from their lives. The mesh survivors have campaigned relentlessly for some form of justice for years and years. There probably isn't an MSP in this building who has not been contacted by them or listened to their story. Ensuring they don't have to pay for essential surgery out of their own pocket is the least we can do to correct this historic injustice. They have experienced it, and we can help from within this Parliament. I implore the Scottish Government to join with Scottish Labour today and start a new chapter in our country's history by championing the rights of women to receive fair and effective health care. It should not be too much to ask. Support this amendment, which I move in my name. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Mochen. I now call on Gillian Mackay. You have 4 minutes, Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to take this opportunity to congratulate the Minister on her appointment. I look forward to working with her over the coming years. And thank you to everyone who have sent in briefings ahead of this debate. Women are more likely to have heart disease misdiagnosed. They're more likely to have their physical symptoms either dismissed entirely or put down to their mental health. My own parents, for example, were told when I first started experiencing symptoms of my disability that I was embellishing my hearing loss and the dizziness I was experiencing was probably either linked to my periods or stress. Women need to be believed when they go for help. Being told that your physical pain is all in your mind will undoubtedly stop you from trying to access healthcare in the future. When many healthcare campaigns encourage people to get checked early, to ask their doctor if they notice anything unusual, we should be trying our best to ensure that everyone's healthcare concerns are taken seriously. Heart disease is often something we perceive as being a condition that particularly affects men. Ischemic heart disease kills 2,600 women a year in Scotland. Currently, tests are not as accurate in diagnosing heart attacks in women compared with men, and 7 women a day will die from ischemic heart disease. That's 7 families devastated. That doesn't take into account those that survive and then have to live with long-term conditions, usually on blood thinners, for the rest of their lives. Often we look at decisions in this chamber through an economic lens. We look at the loss to the economy from those who cannot work after a heart attack. We look at how much it costs to run a service or a campaign, but what we decide here affects actual lives. Preventing a heart attack is the difference between keeping a family keeping or losing a mum, sister or daughter. Between someone being able to enjoy their life in the way they did and having that irreversibly changed. Any family who's experienced this will tell you that no price can be put on saving a loved one's life. We know, however, that income and deprivation are strongly linked to positive health outcomes. In partnership with promoting good health, we need to tackle poverty and other drivers of poor health. Even though my amendment was not selected, I want to cover some of the issues raised in it. Pregnant women and new mothers have been particularly negatively affected by the pandemic. Women who have been pregnant and given birth during the pandemic have been hit hard by the restriction and loss of some services. During the first lockdown in 2020, restrictions put in place included barring partners from attending antenatal screenings and limiting the time they could be present during labour. Whilst these restrictions have now largely been lifted, they have had a profound impact on the health and well-being of new parents and their relationships with their child. And pregnant women still can't access all the services they are entitled to. In-person antenatal classes are still suspended, with most health boards offering online e-learning modules instead. These are a poor substitute for the supportive environment of traditional antenatal groups, which are often a lifeline for first-time parents. Free dental care for new mothers is also something women are struggling to access, and I'm aware of a growing number of women who now have to pay for expensive dental treatment because they couldn't access dental appointments over the last year and have now passed the one-year free window for treatment after giving birth. Free dental treatment is a recognition of the impact pregnancy can have on the oral health of new mothers, and we should be doing all we can to ensure women take this up. My colleague Mark Ruskell has written to the Cabinet Secretary to ask him to extend this provision to 2 years post-birth for the foreseeable future, and I would encourage him to reflect on that proposal if it is the Cabinet Secretary that's summing up. This would be a simple but effective measure to try and redress unequal impact that the pandemic has had on women's health. We would also like to see the government commit to retaining the provision for early medical abortions at home that was introduced during the pandemic. And we would want to see the end to the two-doctor rule and the establishment of buffer zones around abortion clinics and sexual health clinics. No one should be harassed while trying to access healthcare. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Wilkin-Mackay. Elegantly done in incorporating your amendment as well. I now call on Beatrice Wishart for 4 minutes, after which we'll move to the open debate. Ms. Wishart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm grateful too for the opportunity to take part in this debate and to help bring issues around women's health in from the sidelines. Many of us scoffed when news broke in 2016 about the trials of male contraceptive pills being called to a halt. They ran aground because the participants were experiencing headaches, mood swings, and weight gain, all symptoms that are well known in the female experience of contraception. But that point is worth more than just a roll of the eyes, because it clearly shows the inequality that's at the heart of this debate. To this day, there's a mainstream expectation that there are levels of pain and discomfort that women should just live with. Risks are excused or normalised for women, while simultaneously seen to be too much for the population at large. Women consistently report experiences of not being listened to in healthcare. As Engender set out recently, and I quote, they wait longer for pain medication than men, wait longer to be diagnosed, are more likely to have their physical symptoms ascribed to mental health issues, are more likely to have their heart disease misdiagnosed or to become disabled after a stroke, and are more likely to suffer illnesses ignored or denied by the medical profession. So there's a huge amount of work that needs to be done to rectify that situation. The Women's Health Plan will be a start, but it's taken such a long time to get the conversation started, so we shouldn't underestimate the effort it will take to establish real change. The Determined campaign run by mesh survivors is a testament to that. Their experiences of botched treatment are nothing short of a public health catastrophe, but the response from the government has been slow. Presiding officer, their asks shouldn't be up for debate. We need to do whatever it takes for these women. Funding for removal surgery so women have a choice about where this is done and who by. And a patient safety commissioner and a statutory ban so this never happens again. My amendment, had it been selected, raised the question of dedicated facilities for perinatal loss. Louise Caldwell has campaigned bravely on this issue. She was required to deliver on a labour ward after being told that there was no heartbeat at a 12-week scan. She said, and I quote, as soon as you enter the labour ward, you are met with newborn baby photos on walls, thank you cards, baby cries and proud partners. It's really difficult to imagine how hard that must be. Official guidance says that separate facilities should be provided. So while there may be recognition, as Louise's experience shows, that recognition does not always translate into reality. There needs to be a standard of care for perinatal loss equivalent to that provided to patients undergoing labour and delivery. Perinatal mental health also needs to be brought to the forefront of the plan. A 2018 report showed that only Glasgow, in the whole of Scotland, was meeting perinatal mental health requirements. Mothers in half of Scotland couldn't access specialist services. This was years after another report warned of significant gaps. I hope the Minister might address that in her closing remarks and commit to making perinatal health and mental health a cornerstone of the Government's plan.
Thank you, Ms. Wishart. That's, I think, all the amendments given an airing. We now move to the open debate. The first speaker will be Evelyn Tweed, who will be followed by Craig Hoy. And the Chamber will be aware that this is Ms. Tweed's first speech in the Chamber. You have around 4 minutes, Ms. Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and welcome to your new role, and also congratulations to Mary Todd. It is a privilege and honour of my life to be standing in Scotland's Parliament making my first speech. I only wish my parents had lived to see this day. I have no qualms in stating that I come from a very poor background and have lived through periods of homelessness and living hand to mouth.
Ms. Tweed, I don't want to miss any of this. Could you maybe just move your microphone up just a little bit?
Is that better?
That should be fine, yeah.
Thank you. Growing up in a council estate in the Thatcher years really shaped my views on social justice and led to a 25-year career in housing, building homes for people in need before I was elected as a councillor. I was once told by a friend that I should never go into politics as I cared too much. Well, I believe that all the best politicians care too much. That is why I got elected, to speak up for the most vulnerable, to help people, and to be a voice for women, who, whilst on average, enjoy longer lives, more of our lives are spent in ill health. For too long, women who are our mothers, daughters, sisters, carers, have not been adequately supported. And I am so proud that an SNP government has clearly improved women's lives. For example, Scotland was the first country in the world to have free period products. And this shows what can be done when we all work in this chamber together. We have the fantastic baby box providing mothers with the essential items they need for their new baby. We have more GPs per head of population than any UK country. But there is still so much more to do. Many health issues in the past have been described as women's problems, whether this be endometriosis or the menopause, both of which I have experienced. I have endured endometriosis all my adult life, resulting in chronic pain and at times misery. This was dismissed as period pain, and it took until my late 30s when I collapsed at work to finally get some support. I don't want any other woman to go through what I went through. There is no cure, and as we've heard today, most women wait over 8 years for a diagnosis, which is just not good enough. I'm delighted that the SNP government has committed to reduce the diagnosis time to 12 months by the end of this parliament. It's also fantastic that we now talk openly about menopause, a process that will affect over half of our population. The SNP will ensure women have improved access to advice and support on the diagnosis and management of menopause. Let's work together across this chamber to improve services and reduce health inequalities for women and girls. Let's become a global leader in this field. I ultimately believe that independence and having the full fiscal powers to make our own decisions will help us tackle all inequalities and ensure that all our citizens have equal access to food, housing, and healthcare. Presiding Officer, as I draw to a close, allow me to offer my heartfelt thanks to the people who made my being here today possible. My brilliant husband, Asan, my rock and love of my life, my daughter, Emily, who is a force of nature and a campaigner extraordinaire, our family and friends, my fantastic campaign team, my predecessor, Bruce Crawford, my modern studies teachers at school for my fierce love of politics, and David Shearer, long-time friend and mentor. Your advice paid off. Thank you to everyone who voted in the wonderful Stirling constituency. I commit now to listen to you, to be guided by you, and to work for you. Thank you.
Well done, Ms Tweed. I now call on Craig Hoy, will be followed by Kenneth Gibson. Mr Hoy, 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I welcome you to your place and also the Minister to her new position. Deputy Presiding Officer, the consequences of COVID will live with us for a long time to come, and nowhere will these consequences be more severely felt than in our health and social care services. Failure will be measured in lives lost, life-threatening conditions undiagnosed, and mental health problems untreated. The consequences will be acutely felt by patients and their families, but they will also be felt by our frontline health and social care staff. And they are more likely to be felt by women. It will be your gran, your mum, your sister, your daughter, your wife, your civil partner, your aunt, or your girlfriend who confronts these consequences and these inequalities. Take mental health. Across Scotland, we are facing an escalating mental health crisis, a crisis made worse by repeated failures by the SNP government. Women are nearly twice as likely as men to confront the dark cloud of depression. One in five women suffered depression during pregnancy. And it's not just adult women. A study by Mindwell concludes that gender differences, which can impact girls' mental health, start to emerge at the age of 12. And that's why the sudden and shocking surge in treatment times for child and adolescent mental health services must be urgently addressed by ministers. Campaign group Engender warns that women and girls face significant barriers to good mental and physical health for decades. They warn that women are often missed by health services or by public health awareness campaigns. So I hope that the Scottish Government's Women's Health Plan comes forward with robust interventions. Looking to social care, again, the shortcomings are more likely to impact women. In Scotland, there are twice as many women as men living in long-term care. The Scottish Conservatives welcome many of the findings of the Feely Review into social care. But as we explore the creation of a national care service, we must reach beyond the vague but worthy goal of a system based on human rights. We must look towards a system designed around the needs of the individual, a system which marries traditional approaches with new technology, a system which supports home-based care so that more older women can live independently at home and for longer, a system which tackles the staffing and recruitment crisis, and a system which fixes the funding formula for the long term. So when we talk about recovery, we need to recognise the impact that COVID has had on staff in social care and our NHS, the vast majority of whom are women. In fact, 11% of working women in Scotland work in our NHS, compared to just 3% of working men. So when our NHS staff talk of stress and strain, it's women who are most likely to be at the front line. Deputy Presiding Officer, we must do more to close the gender pay gap in our health and social care services. On average, women earn 18.2% less than men in our NHS. And the gap is widest in admin functions and in personal and social care services. My colleague Annie Wells rightly set out the areas where women are being failed, both in terms of diagnosis and in terms of access to primary care services. Women's health problems are often dismissed, underestimated, or are simply diagnosed too late. Women working in our NHS and our care services are often stressed out, burnt out, undervalued, and underpaid relative to men. And we need to recognise these problems. And we in this Parliament need to resolve these problems. And if concerted action today is one of the few silver linings of the COVID pandemic, then we must work together to take it. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Hoy. And I call on Kenneth Gibson, who will be followed by Clare Baker. Mr Gibson, 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And firstly, I would like to congratulate my colleague Evelyn Tweed on her excellent first speech in this chamber. Women's health is important to men too. We have mothers, daughters, sisters, wives, partners, female friends and colleagues. In the treatment of illness, women cannot be second best. In 2019, I participated in a meeting of the cross-party group on women's health, ably chaired by Monica Lennon, at which the British Heart Foundation's report, Bias and Biology, was presented. Shockingly, the report showed that ischemic heart disease, the leading cause of death for women in Scotland, is more likely to go untreated, undiagnosed, or diagnosed later in women than in men. There is also less awareness of symptoms, signs of heart attacks as they happen, and a lower likelihood of receiving scans. A previous BHF-funded 2018 study showed that women who have an NSTEMI, non-ST elevation myocardial infarction, a type of heart attack where the coronary artery is usually partially blocked, are a shocking 34% less likely to receive coronary angiography within 72 hours of the first symptoms than men. My last question in this chamber before Parliament dissolved in March was how much progress had been made in addressing this over the last 2 years. It was encouraging to hear from the previous Public Health Minister that the Women's Health Plan will include cardiac disease as a key pillar and implementation will align with the Heart Disease Action Plan, which highlights the importance of tackling inequalities in access to diagnosis, treatment and care. I look forward to actions evolving from both plans and believe that ministers should strive to ensure equality of health outcomes at the earliest possible date. Women may have a higher life expectancy than men, but quality of life matters too. The SNP 2021 manifesto includes a commitment to improve the experience and diagnosis of women who visit their GPs with menstrual problems. Improved diagnosis and management of the menopause and legislation in aid of transvaginal mesh survivors will also help better the quality of many women's lives. Scottish ministers will explore ways in which the baby box can be used to further promote women's health and support parental mental health. The time is also right to progress the Women's Health Plan. Since it first appeared in the 2019-20 programme for government, much of the focus and many resources relating to health understandably shifted during the past 16 months. However, I'm glad the plan is prioritised in the government's first 100 days. The Endo Warriors and other women across Scotland will be pleased to see endometriosis specifically mentioned in the government's motion. The sad reality is that it's only over the last few years that endometriosis, which Evelyn Tweed described her own experiences so eloquently, has been recognised as a hugely impactful condition is for one in every 10 women. The opening of the West of Scotland accredited endometriosis unit in April 2019, which I actually campaigned for, means that women and girls who live in the West and require specialised treatment no longer have to go to Edinburgh or Aberdeen, with travel often prohibitive for financial reasons. Nevertheless, the fact that my February 2017 endometriosis members debate was only the second in 18 years of this Parliament, the first being led by Annabel Goldie in the first Parliament, and it took another 2 years for NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde to set up the specialist unit, tells me women's health has not always received the urgent focus I believe it merits. The SNP manifesto commits to reduce average waiting times for diagnosing endometriosis from 8 years to less than one by the end of this Parliament, as we have already heard. This is ambitious, given it's such a difficult condition to diagnose, but it's an ambition worth striving for and one I will follow closely. Presiding Officer, I'd finally like to remind any new male MSP that it is also your place to raise issues concerning women's health. We must all do what we can to improve women's health. It's important for every one of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. A timely warning to all of us. I now call on Claire Baker, who will be followed by Emma Roddick. Ms Baker, 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I very much welcome this afternoon's debate on women's health. The creation of a plan which provides a coordinated, inclusive strategy for women's health is overdue, and I'm pleased that this session of Parliament is looking to focus on women's health, bringing together many of the issues that MSPs and campaigners have pressed on for years. It is welcome that we recognise the connectedness of all these issues, that women's health has been marginalised, unacknowledged, devalued, and that there has been and continues to be systematic or institutional or societal failures in the treatment that women receive and in the public health messages and support they receive. Invisible Women, the book referred to by the Minister, revealed the inequalities of a society which is created for men. From the ridiculous, the temperature within our offices, to the dangerous, the design of seatbelts in cars, the needs of women were just ignored, perhaps not deliberately or maliciously, but women were treated as second-class citizens, given not even an afterthought in planning or design. This has affected all areas of society, including healthcare. Perez highlights the example of health disease, its perception as a male disease, and the consequences of women facing misdiagnosis and disadvantage in treatment is also addressed in the British Heart Foundation's Bias and Biology briefing paper, as mentioned by Kenneth Gibson. It is welcome the Scottish Government is now recognising the specific needs of women with heart disease, but the study does point towards inequalities at every stage of a woman's medical journey and the importance of a much broader rethink, which I hope the Women's Health Plan will bring. The lack of support for women experiencing perimenopause and menopause is gaining a higher profile, and that is welcome. We are seeing more open debate and discussions about symptoms women can experience and more effort to reduce stigma, to tackle shame, which is driven by decades, if not centuries, of the representation of women as crazy or barren simply for experiencing a natural process. In her book, Perimenopausal Power, Maisie Hill makes clear the broader impacts of menopause symptoms and how these can affect relationships and work performance. The average age of menopause is 51, and the age group with the highest suicide rate for women is 50 to 54. This is a stark fact, and one that only highlights the importance of evidence-based guidance and support being provided, including the use of HRT. It is vital that women can access proper support, and routes to specialist care need to be improved. While there is only one specialist centre in Scotland for menopause, the first port of call in most instances is a GP. We must ensure that women are confident their concerns will be listened to by GPs and not be deterred from asking for help. Misdiagnosis is a key issue in women's health, and too often women have felt that they've had their point of view dismissed when approaching their GP. We must increase the number of specialists available and training for GPs, reduce waiting times and encourage self-referral so that access to treatment is straightforward and responsive. We need to see workplace strategies that better recognise change throughout women's lives and how they impact on their working lives. The Alliance report on future planning was brought together by the lived experience subgroup of the Women's Health Group. Women highlight difficulties in accessing services, particularly for some marginalised groups. They also highlight that there was no mention of mental health in the plan, with the focus on physical health, although I do recognise the Minister's opening comments on that. Making appointments around work and caring responsibilities is still difficult. The need for GP referrals for specialist services can add a further layer of delay. Requesting female GPs or interpreters can put additional pressure on those seeking appointments. We must have clear, accurate and up-to-date information readily available online, including accessible videos and a range of physical locations in other language. And I'll just briefly mention the need for investment into research as well into women's health. So a women's health plan is vital to address inequalities in health provision, to provide standards and deliver expectations for women's health needs, and to ensure that when women seek health services, they are taken seriously and provided with choices to enable them to live healthy, rewarding lives. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Baker. I now call on Emma Roddick, who joins us remotely, after which it will be Rachel Hamilton. Ms Roddick, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In my first speech, I raised the hope that our new Minister for Women's Health would place importance on improving treatment for endometriosis and menopause. I want to repeat that hope today and also urge the Scottish Government to address in the Women's Health Plan what is more than a shortfall, but a result of many years of lack of understanding, concern and motivation throughout society to do anything about substandard care. It's not simply a political problem. This is ingrained. It is an issue in medical research, it's an issue in academia and in society in general. Women's health takes a back seat. We get fewer research grants, we take the birth control, we take the hit. This Parliament must show leadership on this issue. And I talk about the value of lived experience a lot, and this is an issue where it is necessary. Perception does not always match reality, and it is vital that any discussions about these issues are led by those who experience them firsthand, or outcomes are going to be ineffective. Particularly when we talk about issues like menstruation and menopause, which have historically been ignored or hidden away, to continue the conversation as it is now means to work off outdated assumptions, myths and misbelief. We have to start again. I also hope that while we are describing these issues as women's health issues, efforts will be made to make sure that people who are not women but also suffer these issues feel able to enter the conversation and seek better care. Given we still aren't past the point of requiring euphemisms to talk about periods or using blue liquid to denote menstrual blood, it is going to be quite a challenge to raise awareness about and treatment standards for endometriosis and dysmenorrhea. But we must. As someone who has been hospitalised many times due to my period, I hope to see wider recognition that for many who menstruate, it's not just a cramp, it's not just an annoyance, it is something that causes excruciating pain, which not even morphine will fully relieve. It's something that prohibits your mobility and causes chronic pain throughout the month, and is often completely misunderstood and stigmatised by workplaces or even doctors themselves. I'm really glad to see the Scottish Government aims to reduce waiting times for a diagnosis of endometriosis to 12 months. However, in order to do that, we have to recognise and admit that one of the reasons it takes so long at the moment is that those seeking help with their periods are being dismissed. We are accused of exaggerating pain, of it being because we are size 14 instead of size 8, and especially if you have mental health issues, of being essentially hysterical, with doctors suggesting it's all in your head as you're curled up on the bathroom floor screaming in pain and waiting for an ambulance. It's not just that there's a long assessment period or a lack of research and available treatment. It is that we are sent home from the GP over and over with a wave of the hand, a pack of paracetamol, a prescription for methanamic acid, and then maybe, if we're lucky, an appointment with someone else in a few months. Given how hard it is to break down assumptions about menopause, I realise it's going to be quite a challenge to raise awareness of early menopause. but we must do that as well. If an employee approaches their boss and says they're struggling and the reaction is a laugh, a joke or disbelief because they're not old enough, that's unacceptable. Presiding Officer, we have a long way to go and I'm committed to doing my bit to bring lived experience into the discussion, raise awareness and work with the government to make life better for those suffering issues typically experienced by women. But we must begin from a point of understanding just how bad the situation is.
Thank you. I call Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Never has there been more pressing time than the present to debate women's health issues. After the past 15 months, we have seen waiting times soar, an increase in the backlog of cancelled operations, and cancer diagnostic tests shelved. Even young pupils have been affected by not receiving either the first or the second HPV vaccine within the 18-month time, which is crucial at this stage when these young people are becoming sexually active. In the coming months, it is crucial that we have these services fully up and running. Women's health has for far too long taken a back seat, and I'm keen to see change, as are so many people in this chamber. A starting point for me came in 2019 when Monica Lennon and I hosted an event with the British Heart Foundation to discuss women's health inequalities, particularly on diagnosing heart disease. And at a similar point, Caroline Criado-Perez's book was published addressing a clear gap in women's health treatments as raised by the minister. And more recently, I was troubled by the experience of a friend from the borders who has been waiting for an endometriosis diagnosis for years. Without a doubt, urgent action must be taken to address the appalling waiting time length in endometriosis diagnosis. It's very common. It affects 10% of women from puberty to menopause, although the impact, as Evelyn Tweed has described, may affect you for life. The average time for diagnosis has been stated as 8 years. It's not. In Scotland, it's 8.5, Presiding Officer. And we know that access to services for these women is very difficult. The inquiry in the UK APPG attracted 10,000 responses and noted that in Scotland, it's been difficult to access treatment. There are specialist units in Edinburgh, Glasgow and Aberdeen. But if you live out with those specific local authority areas, it seems, and I loathe to use this description, it is a postcode lottery. Cabinet Secretary, these women are experiencing physical and emotional suffering, and this government needs to act. The report is well worth a read. It commits to reducing the average diagnosis time to 4 years or less by 2025 and a year or less by 2030. I challenge this government to meet its manifesto commitment because it hasn't met its legally binding treatment guarantee time yet of 12 weeks. Cabinet Secretary, in Scotland, our cross-party support ended period poverty and provided free sanitary products in schools. It's brought plaudits across the globe, and therefore a reduction in waiting times, access to specialist endometriosis service and menstrual health education in schools should be a key priority. And I ask that the Minister addresses this in her closing. Secondly, cancer diagnosis and treatment, especially cervical and breast cancer, has fallen by the wayside during the pandemic, with women particularly let down. 4,000 fewer people have received cancer diagnosis when cancer screening and detection tests were on hold from April to June last year. And breast cancer represents almost a quarter of these missing cases, over 70% more than what would be expected, prompting fears that progress against fighting the disease is in jeopardy. We need to see proper funding, and I would also ask the Minister if the cervical screening awareness campaign has been re-enabled. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I think I'm going to have to go to the end here, but we on these benches today are calling to tackle the NHS backlog. Through our amendment, we want to see a separate clinician-led fund so that we can finally bring treatment time guarantees under control, and we cannot continue on the trajectory that we're on. Women's health is at stake.
Thank you. I call Siobhan Brown to be followed by Martin Whitfield. This is Ms. Brown's first speech in the chamber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I thank the Minister for this important debate today on women's health. It's so important that we do not ignore early signs of disease, and early diagnosis can be life-saving. As part of the Scottish Government Health Recovery Plan, I welcome the opening next week of the Early Cancer Diagnosis Centre in Ayr, and encourage people not to ignore concerns and get in touch with your doctor. It is the biggest privilege to stand here today as a first SNP member and first woman to be elected to represent the people of Ayr, Prestwick and Troon at the Scottish Parliament. I would not be here today if it wasn't with the support and commitment of my campaign team. And I'd like to thank Con, Ian, Alison and Becca, and all the local activists who put their hearts and soul into helping win this seat. Their extraordinary efforts mean that I am able to join my other four SNP MSPs together, representing all the people in South Ayrshire. I'd like to thank all the people that trusted me with their vote, and I will work hard to repay your trust. For those that didn't vote for me, please be assured I'm your MSP too. I am determined to represent each and every one of my constituents to the best of my abilities in Holyrood. I would also like to pay tribute to my predecessor, John Scott, who represented the people of Ayr, Prestwick and Troon for 21 years. Although our politics are different, I have the utmost respect for him. He is a highly regarded member of the Scottish Parliament, and I wish him health and happiness. Politics and public life can be somewhat challenging at times to family life, so I'd like to thank my husband and my children for their support and patience. I am lucky to represent a beautiful part of the world on the picturesque west coast of Scotland. It's the Ayr seat, but it also includes the neighbouring towns of Prestwick and Troon. We have many valuable resources, such as our world-class golf courses, Robert Burns Heritage, Prestwick Airport and Aerospace Industries, Troon Port and Yacht Marina, a University of West of Scotland campus, and in normal times, a buzzing restaurant and nightlife. If you've never been before, I urge you to come and visit my constituency. Weather permitting, you might be rewarded with a sunset over Arran, which even during a pandemic, you will appreciate life. My constituency is fortunate to have many areas of affluence, but it also has very high areas of levels of deprivation. Years of Tory austerity have impacted heavily on the resilience of our poorest communities and increased the difference in life chances of our young and our old. A child is twice as likely to be growing up in poverty in some parts of Ayr North as one living in Troon, for example, and the life expectancy of a child born today is around 10 years less in our poorest areas to our most affluent. Tory austerity and social welfare cuts have exacerbated inequality. This cannot be denied nor excused, and more so since they have now been revealed as a deliberate policy choice and not an economic necessity. That's why the Scottish Government's renewed commitment to tackling child poverty is so welcome. Measures like doubling the Scottish child payment of £20 per week in the first year of Parliament, already described as a poverty game changer, will help give the children in our communities the life chances we wish for them all. There are inequalities in our communities at the other end of the age spectrum too. I'm sure MSPs are aware of the levels of pension of poverty are higher, and the state pension is lower in the UK than in most of Western Europe. The stolen pensions from the WASPI women is a national scandal. Given that the proportion of my constituents over 65 is higher than the average for Scotland, this is a huge concern to me. In one of the richest countries in the world, all our elderly citizens should be able to live in dignity in old age and receive the levels of care they deserve. So I'm delighted the Scottish Government has made it a priority to establish a national care service on par with the NHS and has committed to scrapping charges for non-residential care. Perhaps the most important of our local assets are our young people. Like kids pretty much all around the world, the pandemic has had a huge impact on their education, their lives in general, and even their mental health. As we help our young people get their lives back on track, we must take the opportunity to consider what kind of country we want them to grow up in and who we want to lead a fairer, greener recovery. That's something which should be and will be decided by the people of Scotland. They have returned an SNP to government with a landslide victory, and their will has to be respected. The COVID pandemic needs to be a priority, but when the time is right, the people of Scotland should have the choice to determine their future. This is not about being divisive. This is about being democratic. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Martin Whitfield.
I'm grateful, Presiding Officer. And it is a true tribute to follow Siobhan Brown in such a powerful first speech. And she speaks so powerfully of her community, and I think they bode well in her hands, although clearly with a slight political disappointment from this side of the chamber. I would like to take the short time that I have in this debate to talk about the menopause and to follow on from Claire Baker and indeed Emma Roddick's powerful contributions, and also to invite the Cabinet Secretary at the end to expand on the welcome inclusion of the word menopause in the motion. Back in 2018, on World Menopause Day, I led a backbench debate in Westminster, and although the debate itself was supported across the House, it is sad that in reality so little has changed since then. I embarked on my new career in my 50s, and I cannot imagine embarking on a new career struggling with some of the symptoms that my female counterparts experience and suffer without help or support. Indeed, I think it is unthinkable that a society would ask men at the height of their careers to simply tolerate the symptoms, to carry on. Actually, can you do it quietly as well? Why should women? All too often, the menopause is seen as something that women need simply to cope with. They are afraid to discuss the symptoms openly with friends, family, and sometimes, most importantly, work colleagues, because they are afraid of being undermined and indeed perhaps marginalised. 70% of women do not discuss their symptoms at work. A third do not visit their GP. 50% report the menopause affects their mental health and their ability to work. To echo the STUC General Secretary, Ros Foyer, who has called for a sea change in workplace attitudes, as midlife women struggle to get simple adjustments to their working conditions. Women workers are being failed by employers. They make no provision for the impact of the menopause. The STUC Women's Committee report back in January 2018 identified that 99% of respondents either did not have or did not know if their workplace had a menopause policy. 32% said the menopause was treated negatively at the workplace. And perhaps most frighteningly, 63% said the menopause had been treated as a joke. The STUC have called for greater development of menopause workplace policies to better support staff who are experiencing the menopause, as well as to educate the wider workforce to help remove the associated stigma. As my colleague Carolyn Harris MP in Westminster quoted from a call to evidence only a few days ago, the experience reported is worth repeating. Simple changes in the workplace, such as flexible working hours, relaxed uniform policies, adaptations to the working environment, can make all the difference. And I commend the Law Society of Scotland for their work with PEPI to develop menopause advice for employers. We on this side have called for the introduction of a right to choose flexible working for all workers. For women experiencing the symptoms of menopause, flexible working could help them manage potential tiredness, work from home where necessary, or even take time off to attend appointments. I welcome the SNP manifesto commitment to launch a public health campaign to remove the stigma and raise awareness of symptoms of menopause, and I look forward to confirmation that this will appear in the plan. And I also welcome the Minister's confirmation that women's health will be looked at holistically, and the involvement of a woman's voice in this is so important. Scottish Labour believe that we need to improve access to specialist care in Scotland so that women have access to good advice about the menopause and no longer face long waits for diagnosis. And there is good practice to model this on. NHS Dumfries and Galloway, Lothian, Fife, Grampian have all specialist menopause clinics. I stand here in this debate as a man, and it has to be said that it is time for men to show their solidarity and to break a taboo about talking about the menopause. So I ask every man in this place, I ask every man who's watching, every man in the... Well, no, I just ask men, can you be brave enough to say, could you tell me, can you explain, will you share?
If you could wind up, please.
And to do so with sympathy and empathy. So my challenge to this government is this. Little has changed since 2018. Can you start that change regarding the menopause in the next 100 days? Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Julian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to offer my congratulations to Evelyn Tweed and Siobhan Brown on their first speeches. Many colleagues have raised the importance of women within the NHS and the social care workforce during this debate, and once again, my heartfelt thanks go to every single one of them, and I really don't think we can ever say it enough. Both Annie Wells and Carol Mockin have both mentioned the heroic efforts of transvaginal mesh survivors. The injuries they've faced are appalling, and we must ensure that they have the resolution they need and they can be assured of our support going forward. Many colleagues have also noted that women generally live longer. We have to ensure that women receive the later life and end of life care that gives them the dignity and choice they deserve, and choice within palliative care is essential. One of the greatest barriers to women receiving health care is access. Women report difficulties in accessing appointments and how to fit them around caring, childcare and other responsibilities. We need to make sure that there are flexible appointments for those that need them, and we need to make sure these flexible appointments are at convenient times. These difficulties are often exacerbated for women from BAME backgrounds, disabled women or gypsy traveller women. I've spoken several times in this chamber so far about the need to work across portfolios to ensure we deal with both the inequalities in particular services as well as other factors that exacerbate these inequalities. Income inequality is a driver of poor health. With a lower income, you're less likely to be able to afford good quality food and more likely to live in poor quality housing, and ultimately are likely to die younger than their peers. Food bank use is at a high, and part of that is exacerbated by the pandemic, but it's also exacerbated by inequalities. Being on furlough of 80% of what already was poor wages is not making that inequality any better. This is something that we have an obligation to take really seriously this session. Public Health Scotland suggests on their website that this could be done through a universal basic income, and this is something that we would obviously support. The National Care Service will also be important for women's health over the coming session. As we're all aware, providing care, and particularly unpaid care, is a highly gendered role. The establishment of a National Care Service will hopefully work to removing some of that burden. Guaranteed minimum respite hours for unpaid carers would give women in particular the ability to plan in breaks. And as I said earlier, we believe that carers should be entitled to flexible healthcare appointments. Mental health is an area that isn't particularly covered when we talk about women's health. As many have talked about at various times, mental health support is critical, whether that be in supporting those with postnatal depression or women struggling with menopause. We need to see a shift in funding for mental health and more of a focus put on talking therapies and peer support. Many women I've spoken to reference that, particularly with menopause support, they would like to see more peer support built in. And to finish off, I also wanted to mention the improvements we need to make, as Emma Roddick outlined, in making improvements to trans and non-binary healthcare when we are designing services. Some non-binary and trans people bleed. They will require many of the services we've spoken about today, and we need to ensure that these services are accessible to them as well, while ensuring they meet their needs. We need to end the years-long waiting for gender clinics and ensure the health service recognises the needs of this often very marginalised community. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by also congratulating Siobhan Brown and Evelyn Tweed on their first speeches in the Chamber. I welcome the opportunity to close the debate for Scottish Labour, and it has indeed been encouraging to see the contributions across the Chamber that point to areas where members can work together and make early progress. Carol Mockin was right to reference Monica Lennon's bill on period poverty as groundbreaking. It was initially opposed by the SNP, but we do welcome all converts. There is also unfinished business for mesh survivors, and I will turn to that later. Claire Baker talked about the need for specialist menopause services. Martin Whitfield also talked about workplace strategies to support women experiencing menopause and spoke powerfully about stigma. as did Emma Roddick in her contribution. There is equally much to welcome in the Minister's opening speech, and I very much look forward to working with her, because we do need more than just a women's health plan in the first 100 days of this government. Women need to see action. And they need it now, because for the first time since modern records began, life expectancy in 2015 to 2017 dropped on the SNP's watch. Life expectancy of women from the least deprived areas, where you compare that to the most deprived areas, there is in fact a 10-year gap. And Scottish women have the lowest life expectancy of all the UK countries. So we need action. Action on a catch-up plan for breast cancer screening, cervical cancer screening, to clear the backlog and identify patients in need of treatment. Recent minutes from the National Cancer Recovery Group tell us that they don't know when the 36-month interval will be the norm for breast cancer screening. Can the Minister tell us that in her closing speech? They also note that the self-referral process for women over 70 has been paused and remains paused. Can the Minister tell us when this will resume? And what about the persistent inequality that exists between poorer households and those from more affluent areas? The drop-off in screening rates, the consequent rise in cancer incidence in poorer areas also needs to be addressed. And as Kenny Gibson rightly raised, action on endometriosis services and waiting times. Action on specialist services for women experiencing menopause. Presiding Officer, there is a significant agenda here, and I do look forward to working with the Minister to improve services for women and ultimately to improve women's health. But I want to use the remaining time to talk about the Scottish Mesh Survivors campaign. The Mesh scandal started when I was last Shadow Health spokesperson. I met Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy, founders of the Mesh Survivors Group, more than 5 years ago. Progress has been glacial, despite the considerable efforts of those formidable women and colleagues in the chamber, principally Jackson Carlaw, Alex Neil, and Neil Findlay. The latter two have, of course, left the parliament, so we need to make sure that the focus remains, because there are hundreds and thousands of women who are suffering because they have been injured by the use of mesh implants in their surgery. The extreme pain that many women suffered was denied by clinicians and denied by the Scottish Government for too long. The group have produced a charter of mesh care, calling for the suspension of the use of mesh until there is a statutory ban, calling for a mesh removal fund to pay the cost of mesh removal by a surgeon of the patient's choosing, and that also covers those women who have been forced to pay for a removal surgery that was simply not available in Scotland. The Minister will be aware that Dr. Veronicus offered to help to remove mesh from Scottish women using a tissue-sparing technique. His offer appeared to be blocked by the Scottish Government, something subsequently confirmed by the government's own mesh expert. That was bad enough, but there was a further scandal. Women operated on by Scottish surgeons were told that their mesh had been completely removed, but this simply wasn't true. The removal was only partial. Now we have a Scottish Centre of Excellence for mesh removal, but are they removing all the mesh? We don't know. We don't even know if there's further muscle or tissue damage. So will the Minister ensure that this is being monitored and reported on? And the Minister will be aware that women do not want to see the same surgeons removing the mesh that implanted it in them in the first place. Dr. Veronicus has submitted a tender to carry out mesh removal. He did this 3 months ago, but since then, nothing has been heard. Presiding Officer, the women simply cannot wait any longer. And I genuinely hope that the Minister agrees with me and agrees to take urgent action, not just for the mesh women, but actually for all women in Scotland. I pledge again to work with the Minister in the interests of women, but there needs to be a greater sense of urgency about the challenges women face, and the pace of change needs to be faster. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Sandesh Gohan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Declaration of interest, I'm a practicing doctor. Healthcare inequality exists. In fact, it is rife both in the health service and society at large. This is never more true than with regards to gender. Women's health has long been an issue denied by, dictated by, and decided by men. Now, it may seem perverse, therefore, that I am standing up here talking about it, but when I see the needs of my patients not being addressed, then I am forced to speak up. And we need to be clear that women includes transgender patients. Trans men and non-binary individuals require access to many of our services in a sensitive and inclusive manner. If Scotland is your home, then you are one of us. The root of our problem is that health and care systems have been designed by men for men. White Caucasian men are the default patients, research models, and target demographic in a lot of cases. And sadly, very little has been done to alter the status quo of the system since its inception to better represent our current society and values. Women's health has been marginalised and stigmatised with taboos. Look at the stigma of the HPV virus in cervical cancer and screening. Lack of knowledge, lack of teaching, and research inequalities. Women also suffer when it comes to work, bearing the brunt of childcare and tending to have less job security. And the gender pay gap, as Craig Hoy just talked about, includes the NHS. We therefore are already behind the curve when it comes to gender equality, as we are rowing against hundreds of years of unequal tides. But surely it's better today, I hear you say. Well, during the pandemic, female staff had significant trouble finding PPE that was fit for purpose because, and you guessed it, the masks were designed to be fitted on men. This literally put women's lives at risk. And this is simply not good enough. And don't be fooled that newer interventions are ironing out the inequality. The digital revolution in healthcare is in fact reinforcing these stereotypes. Currently used treatment algorithms in primary care are sexist. A man presenting with chest pain requires accident and emergency or assessment, as he could be having a heart problem. But a woman presenting with chest pain is thought to be panicking or anxious. It is no coincidence that historically the Greek root of the term hysteria pertains to the uterus. This is how inculcated such ideas have become. They are interwoven into the very fabric of the language we use. We need to stop this casual sexism from creeping into our systems. And for that, we need a bottom-up rethink. We need to change the way we teach topics at medical school to include period health, fertility, menopause, endometriosis, to better represent practical health problems women suffer. And on endometriosis, Rachel Hamilton and Annie Wells spoke of the distressing 8.5-year wait for diagnosis. Evelyn Tweed spoke eloquently on her maiden speech about the misery, pain, and cyclical nature of this horrible disease. I see all too much of it in my surgeries. We need to equip young women with the tools and education they need. Sex education that includes menstruation, pregnancy, contraception, FGM, female genital mutilation, termination, LGBTQ+, and of course, healthy, respectful, empowered relationships. Deliver this to our youth, if I get some time back.
Very briefly, Monica
Lennon. I'm grateful to the member. In the last parliamentary session at the cross-party group in women's health, we heard time and time again that women are not believed, even when they are in forums and feel empowered to raise issues with their GPs or their clinicians. What would the member's advice be to GPs about the action they can take to actively listen to what women are telling them?
Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you. The RCGP, and as a new GP, what we do is we go through a training programme where it's patient-centred and patient-focused, and patients are believed. We have to believe our patients because that is the root of the trust that we hold with our patients. So if a woman feels that they are not being listened to, then my advice to them would be to go back and keep going back until they get the help that they need. So sex education, that includes menstruation, pregnancy, contraception, FGM, termination, LGBTQ+, and of course, healthy, respectful, empowered relationships. Deliver this to our youth, and it gives them information and power, enabling girls to make the decisions by choice not by chance. I wrote an article in Centric magazine in March describing how COVID has disproportionately affected women, as recognised by Marie Todd. This impacts their mental and physical health and social well-being. Women are also at an increased risk of getting long COVID. As declared earlier, I'm a practicing GP, having also worked almost a decade in hospital. So when last week the Cabinet Secretary explained how primary care and secondary care work, I would like to point out that the situation on the ground is vastly different to what he sees in the top-down view. We need long COVID clinics better than England, using their best model as our basis. Kenneth Gibson, Gillian McKay, and Claire Baker spoke of ischemic heart disease, which actually kills three times more women than breast cancer in Scotland, and that's been recognised by the British Heart Foundation of Scotland. Ischemic heart disease in women, as they say, is underaware, underdiagnosed, undertreated, and undersupported. Carol Mocken and Martin Whitfield spoke of menopause, a taboo subject in workplaces where women suffer physical and mental issues in silence. We need to be more open, and I would encourage these women to come to your GP, as we can help. I would like to congratulate Siobhan Brown on her maiden speech and would agree on the beauty of AIR, having worked in AIR Hospital for a year. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, there is much to address with regards to women's health. There are many wrongs to right, and the inertia resisting change within healthcare systems can be exhausting at times. But all these seemingly insurmountable barriers to our sisters, mothers, friends, patients, and to my daughter, I would like to be able to say, nevertheless, we persisted. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Marie Todd to wind up the debate. Minister, you have 9 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and thank you, colleagues. I'm very grateful for your contributions today. Many issues have been raised, and I'll try to respond to all of them, but let me emphasise first that my door is open, and I'm keen to work cross-party on all of these issues. I'd like to say well done to Evelyn Tweed and Siobhan Brown on their first contributions in this chamber. Just wonderful to hear from them, and I'm sure there will be many more wonderful speeches from them. A number of people said that people want action, women want action, not just warm words. So although the plan is yet to be published, I thought I'd update you on a number of progresses that we have made in implementing some early deliverables relating to the plan. Throughout the development of the Women's Health Plan, women have consistently told us that they want information and support to enable them to make informed decisions about their own health and healthcare. And we've listened, and we've launched two women's health awareness campaigns on the NHS Inform website. The first relates to general health throughout the life course, and the second is a specific women's heart health campaign. As we've heard repeatedly throughout the afternoon, that is a specific area that needs attention. Women have also told us how important access to high-quality menopause support and care is. A menopause specialist network has already been established and is meeting regularly online to provide consistent advice and peer support. The network supports primary care teams by providing access to a menopause specialist for consistent advice, support, onward referral, leadership and training. On the issue of cervical cancer, I can confirm to Rachel Hamilton that the TV ad campaign on Going Along for Your Smear has resumed. And just yesterday, the Scottish Government lit up the St Andrew's House because it is Cervical Cancer Awareness Week. To Carol Moshin, I would say you will be aware that there has been a global pandemic. So when that last year, one of the toughest decisions that had to be made in the face of that pandemic last year was pausing the bowel, breast, cervical and abdominal aortic aneurysm and diabetic eye screening programmes. The pause was implemented to reduce the risk of participants becoming infected with COVID-19 and to enable physical distancing and to minimise the impact on essential NHS services as they responded to the virus. I'm pleased to say that the pause was short, so we restarted again in summer last year. Undoubtedly, the infection prevention and control measures and the social distancing have limited capacity, but we've put in extra money towards cervical screening, and that has been to an extra £1 million to support capacity in cervical screening, in sample taking and colposcopy. And there's also two additional mobile breast screening units which have been added to the service to support the breast screening programme and to help it to recovery. And there will be further details coming in the remobilisation plan, which we've committed to in the first 100 days, just how exactly we get back to where we were before with all of these programmes. Also on cervical cancer, Annie Wells raised the issue around health inequality. So as in many cases, women who experience poverty have poorer outcomes. And one of the things that we're doing to tackle that is running a working group to consider how self-sampling for cervical cancer can be introduced into the screening programme. And that could help to significantly tackle inequalities, but the UK Screening Committee hasn't yet approved it. So that's why we are developing the evidence through the working group, and I think that was an issue that one of the Labour members raised in terms of contribution to research. On the issue of mesh, I mean, you know, many of us who have been here for some time have been aware of the challenges around this issue and just how profoundly it has impacted on the women affected. The Scottish Government committed to, in the 2021 manifesto, to pursue the outcomes that were sought by the Scottish Mesh Survivors Charter. The use of transvaginal mesh was formally halted in NHS Scotland in September 2018, and we've committed to continue that halt. Substantial progress has been made to improve services for women with complications, as Jackie Bailey outlined. The new mesh removal service will be subject to continual improvement, which will be informed by consultation with patients. And I hope that will go some way to rebuilding the trust which has been so shattered for those women involved. There will also be a bill introduced into Parliament very soon, I believe, which will allow reimbursement of women who have previously sought private mesh removal. So many of the asks that that particular group of women have made to us, we will be pursuing, and I hope that will help to bring some closure for those women who have been most profoundly impacted. I'll give way.
Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I welcome much of what the Minister has to say, but Dr. Veronicus submitted a tender to carry out mesh removal surgery to the government 3 months ago. We haven't heard anything yet. The women are desperate for this to happen. Can she advise whether there will be progress made quickly?
Minister.
So the short answer is yes. NHS Scotland has invited tenders to allow appropriately qualified surgeons to perform mesh removal for patients in Scotland, and where patients want it to take place outside the NHS, and surgery carried out through this process will be free to patients, but there is a tendering process in place and we need to leave that to take its course. But yes, it will be, we are pursuing it. On the issue of endometriosis, I mean, endometriosis affects about 1 in 10 women, as many people said. It's a very common illness. It's as common as diabetes and as common as asthma. And yet it is rarely talked about. It is dismissed, and women often feel that they are not listened to when they raise the issue of endometriosis. It is still taboo, even in this day and age, to be talking about menstruation and endometriosis. I'm glad to say that we are working very closely with Endometriosis UK to improve the situation for these women. Endometriosis UK and Public Health Scotland and officials have been working together to analyse some of the data. So we heard some anecdotal evidence around women's experience, absolutely vitally important. But the data shows us that there are blockages to treatment and support at primary care level, and there's a real opportunity for us to address these blockages and to make improvements by implementing the NICE guidelines, improving menstrual health resources and education,
And these opportunities are currently reflected in the Women's Health Plan actions. Yes, certainly.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you for taking the intervention. Has that gap analysis been published?
Minister?
I'm not sure, but I can certainly update you. it certainly won't be... I mean, we're working very hard to produce this Women's Health Plan. It'll be part of the information in there. It is certainly public because we are working alongside Endometriosis UK and Public Health Scotland to tackle it, so I'm more than happy to share it with you at some point. As I said, progress is underway to improve implementation of those NICE guidelines and the development of a pelvic pain pathway, and that'll support primary care to recognise the symptoms for endometriosis and provide a timely, standardised referral care pathway for women with suspected endometriosis. And along with Endometriosis UK, we've also recently updated NHS Inform pages, which is an excellent resource, even more widely accessed during the course of the pandemic. And I hope that will support women to recognise the signs and symptoms of endometriosis and speak to their GP. Now, there have been a number of issues raised and covered during this debate. I don't think we'll achieve this ambition overnight. That is why much of our work around the Women's Health Plan is about building the foundations for change, building consensus, and striving for long-term change. This is our opportunity to address systemic inequalities for women and to build a fairer future where health outcomes are equitable right across the whole population of Scotland so that women enjoy the best possible health throughout their lives. Put simply, it is now is the time to act for the women of Scotland. Let's work together to be world leaders in women's health. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on women's health, and the next item of business is consideration of motion 395 on suspension of standing orders. And I call on George Adam on behalf of the Scottish Government to move the motion.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak on the motion. The question is that motion 395 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of three Parliamentary Bureau motions. I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to speak to and move motion 392 on temporary rule changes, and to move motions 393 on establishment of committees and 394 on committee remits.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Initially, I would just like to speak on motion 392, which sets out a temporary change to the standing orders in respect of the remit of the mandatory committee, Europe and External Relations Committee. The remit set out in Rule 6.8 of Standing Orders for that committee refers to matters that are no longer accurate following the UK's departure from the European Union. The motion before the Parliament today sets out an alternative remit and name for the committee, the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee. Once committees are established, it will be a matter for the SPPA committee to consider and make the recommendation to Parliament on the permanent change to the remit of that committee. The temporary rule will therefore apply until either the 31st of December 2021 or until the Parliament takes a decision on a permanent amendment, whichever is earlier. For clarity, members may wish to note the temporary rule change would take effect immediately after it is agreed by the Parliament, and the name and remit set out in the temporary rule are therefore reflected in motion 393 on the establishment of the committees, which the Parliament will also be asked to agree today. And on that note, Presiding Officer, I'd like to move the other amendments as well.
Thank you. The question on these motions will be put at decision time. There are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. And the first is that Amendment 369.1 in the name of Annie Wells, which seeks to amend Motion 369 in the name of Marie Todd on women's health, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.